7-year-old boy is preparing for the big day, December 30th, 1903. He's going to the Iroquois Theater for the spectacular Mr. Bluebeard. Little did he know that he would be experiencing one of the worst disasters in Chicago's history. Chicago, in 1903, was a booming city in which business prospered. People still used horse-drawn carriages, but the occasional automobile was present. As Frank Norris describes Chicago, life was tremendous. All around, on every side, in every direction, the vast machinery of Commonwealth clashed and thundered from dawn till dark and dark till dawn. Even now, as the car carried her further into the business quarter, she could hear it, see it, and feel it in her every fiber. The trepidation of its motion, the great gray city, brooking no rival, imposed its dominion upon a region of a country larger than many a kingdom in the old world. For thousands of miles beyond its confines was its influence felt. And the Iroquois Theater, polished granite, Bedford stone, epic figures of comedy and tragedy surrounding the glass doors. It was elegant, with graceful arched staircases, wrought iron balustrades, and gleaming mirrors. The 53-foot ceilings and unbroken views of the elegant stage made this theater the jewel of theatrical beauty. Until December 30th, 1903.
It's a very famous fire. It happened in Chicago over 100 years ago, and it was a terrible tragedy.
There's 602 people killed, huh?
602.
They counted 200 bodies stacked 10 high and 20 deep.
Businessmen were cutting corners to get the theater done in time for the holidays.
Had no fire alarm or sprinklers, and the emergency smoke vents above the stage were nailed shut.
The exits were unmarked. The fire escapes lay unfinished. The vents, which were supposed to vent out flames and smoke, were nailed shut to keep out rain and snow. To make matters worse, theater officials would lock some of the exits to prevent people from sneaking in without paying their fare. And during the performances, ushers would lock the staircases in the upper level so that no one could sneak down to better seats during the show. And the asbestos curtain, which was supposed to keep out the fire, was made of normal flammable cloth. The perfect death trap. On December 30th, 1903, with a holiday matinee crowd consisting of mostly women and children, tragedy struck. Late in the second act, during the pale moonlight scene, at approximately 3:15 p.m., an arc light shorted and ignited a drop curtain above the stage. The 7-year-old boy described seeing pieces of paper on fire fluttering onto the stage. These were pieces of the burning theater. When the theater first caught on fire, he wanted to dash to the exits, but his mother was saying, "Stay in your seats. This theater is absolutely fireproof." But the theater turned out to be as fireproof as the Titanic was unsinkable.
It set in fire to the velvet curtains. The fire quickly spread to the oil-painted wood, canvas set pieces hanging in the catwalks. When you take wood and you put a varnish or a finish on it, that's flammable.
Some of the stagehands immediately tried to put out the fire with their bare hands, but it was not working. The audience noticed a glow above the stage. At first, they thought it was just part of the show. But then, pieces of the flaming curtain started to flutter down onto the stage. The audience was starting to grow restless, and many of them were getting out of their seats. Eddie Foy, the lead actor and a popular comedian, realized what was happening and tried to calm down the crowd, insisting that the theater was fireproof and asking calmly for the asbestos curtain to be lowered.
When everyone was trampling out, what should the stagehands do? One is you try to get an orderly exit. But if you got this smoke backing down, I'm going to tell you right now, people are not going to leave.
When the fire started to spread, everyone bolted for the exits, including the 7-year-old boy, his mother, his brother, and his 2 aunts. During the stampede, they all got separated. Eddie Foy was still trying to calm the crowd, but no one was listening anymore. Smoke was pouring into the auditorium because the vents on the roof of the theater were nailed shut. Eddie Foy decided to leave before he succumbed to the smoke and flames because there seemed to be nothing he could do. Someone managed to open the huge doors used to handle scenery, allowing a huge draft of air to enter the theater and causing a great blast of flame that shot over the heads of those in the orchestra section and slammed into the balcony, catching over 50 people in their seats and incinerating them on the spot. And then all the rest of the flaming scenery and drop curtains fell onto the stage, immediately shorting out the lights and plunging the theater into total darkness as the stage collapsed. The little boy was stuck at one of the exits with an unfamiliar lock. But when a big blast of fire came from the stage, the boy described his experience as falling from a high wall as streams of black cloth swirled around me. In reality, he had fallen through one of the exits that had been forced open into the alleyway next to the theater. Unfortunately, those in the upper balcony trying to get to the main exit found their way blocked by locked gates designed by the theater owners to keep people from getting to better seats. Over 250 people were asphyxiated by the locked gates, their bodies piling 10 feet high and so tight together that in some cases it took firemen hours to separate them. And those that made it to the fire escapes found them unfinished or jammed with people trying to get out. As many as 150 people may have jumped to their deaths off the unfinished fire escapes. The fire was actually put out only 30 minutes after it started, but by then there were very few people left alive inside the theater. 602 died, 571 on the scene, and 31 from injuries sustained during the fire. Of the dead, 212 were children. The news had spread rapidly, and all of Chicago seemed to be affected by it in some way, having a friend or relative that had died in the fire. Those who weren't affected were horrified by the scale of the tragedy. The world awoke to stunning banner headlines about the fire. Before long, people began to blame the theater owners and even the mayor about the fire. Lawsuits and accusations were tossed back and forth. Theater owners, inspectors, and even the mayor were being called in for trial, but in some cases, trials were delayed for years. Thousands of lawsuits were filed, but the Iroquois Theater Company's total damage payout was under $30,000. And despite all the deliberate violations of the fire code, the only person convicted was a tavern keeper charged with robbing the dead. Although no one was put behind bars, the impact of the Iroquois Theater fire is still felt today. Fire codes were changed and more rigorously enforced.
The Iroquois fire, you know, the Iroquois fire, that fire set the standard for fire codes all across the U.S.
As there was no fire alarm in the theater, a stagehand had to run to the nearest firehouse to report that the theater was in flames. What else came about there then was that all theaters now have fire stations.